On January 1st, 2020, nearly 90,000 people braved cold weather at MetLife Stadium in New Jersey to celebrate finishing reading the entire Talmud. Overflow crowds celebrated indoors at Barclays Center in Brooklyn, and live video feeds connected celebrations around the world, reaching an estimated 1 million people. This event, called the Siyum HaShas, happens every 7.5 years, the time it takes to read the entire 2,711 pages of the Talmud, one page per day. A page of Talmud, by the way, looks like this. It's a masterpiece of graphic design with a layout unchanged for hundreds of years. It's also written in partial sentences in a dead language with no punctuation. So what is the Talmud? And how did this unusual text inspire what might just be the largest and longest-running daily book club of all time? Jewish law is rooted in the Torah, which begins with the creation of the world and traces the Israelites' journey from slavery in Egypt to the Promised Land. Along the way, Moses relays hundreds of mitzvot to the Israelites. Those mitzvot are known as the written Torah. For example, in the Ten Commandments, God says, "But the seventh day is a Sabbath to God. You shall not do any work." The traditional understanding of what those mitzvot mean and how to observe them, like what activities count as work on the Sabbath, is known as the oral Torah, passed down verbally through generations. By the 2nd century CE, there was a concern that this knowledge would be lost due to persecution and migration as Jews began to spread beyond the land of Israel. So rabbis decided to compile the oral Torah into what we call the Mishnah. But they didn't just include the rules. The Mishnah also frequently lists the divergent views of different rabbis, preserving minority opinions alongside the accepted answers. Rabbis continued interpreting and debating the meaning of mitzvot for the next few hundred years, expanding on the discussions in the Mishnah and deliberating about what exactly the Mishnah meant. Eventually, those generations of rabbinic debates were themselves compiled into a document called the Gemara. So, unlike the Mishnah, which is more like a how-to guide with some second opinions, the Gemara is a record of legal arguments, one that includes both the accepted majority opinions as well as the rejected minority opinions. In addition to legal talk, the Gemara also includes stories about the rabbis that teach moral and philosophical lessons. Together, the Mishnah and Gemara are known as the Talmud. The Talmud was first written on scrolls, which was still the Jewish format of choice centuries after the Christian world had started using bound books, though the Jews did get on board with books soon thereafter. And it was written in shorthand with no punctuation, which hadn't been invented yet, in Aramaic, which was the common language in the Middle East at the time, but one that was quickly falling into disuse. Over time, because the wording of the Talmud is brief and sometimes cryptic, and in a language hardly anyone spoke anymore, and because it doesn't always specify which opinion was accepted, rabbis felt compelled to explain what the Talmud meant. Famous Talmud commentators included Rashi in France and Maimonides in Cairo. Commentaries on the Talmud were written as separate books. To study Talmud with commentary, you'd need a finger in each book. In the 11th and 12th centuries, Christian scribes began to copy biblical commentary, called gloss, into their Bibles on the same pages as the biblical text. These glossed Bibles had commentary surrounding the text in geometric columns. Jewish scribes took notice and used that format for their books as well. In the 1450s, the book world exploded with the invention of the printing press. By the 1470s, Jewish printers had learned the technology and were printing their own books. A handful of tractates, individual sections of the Talmud divided by subject, were printed in Spain in the 1480s, as well as in northern Italy by a printer named Joshua Sonsino. Sonsino laid out his Talmud like a glossed Bible, with the Talmud text in the middle and the commentary of Rashi on one side. On the other side, Sonsino, his nephew, and their editors featured a few of their favorite Tosafists. The Tosafists, who included Rashi's own son-in-law and grandsons, tried to explain what Rashi's comments meant, and as the publisher, he could pick the Tosafists he liked best. Printing a book like this took a lot of time and resources, and the Sonsinos only managed to print a few tractates. Enter Daniel Bomberg. Bomberg was a Christian from Antwerp who had moved to Venice. A friend convinced him there was money to be made in Jewish books, so he petitioned the Venetian Senate for the exclusive right to print the Talmud in Venice. Between 1519 and 1523, he printed the first complete set of the Talmud. He unabashedly copied Sonsino's geometric page layout and selection of commentaries, and also added page numbers, which were a new invention at the time. If we're being technical, they're actually folio numbers, meaning each leaf gets a single number for both the front and back of the sheet, which then have an A side and a B side. Within 100 years, this page numbering format would go out of style, and the Talmud is probably the only regularly published book today that still uses this old system. Bomberg's edition, and the two more he printed after the first sold out, were a huge success. His state-sanctioned monopoly, high-quality printing, large print runs, and location in the international business hub of Venice made sure of it. Other printers, some of them also Christian, wanted in on the game and put out their own editions in the 1540s and 50s. These new editions kept Bomberg's successful layout and added useful references to biblical verses and related discussions elsewhere in the Talmud, kind of like a massive Wikipedia citation system. They also added even more commentaries around the page as a sales tool. More commentaries equals better value. Persecution and censorship meant printing the Talmud was a fraught endeavor. But despite that, new editions were printed continually over the next 300 years. Almost every single one used Bomberg's layout. This progression culminated with the Vilna edition of the 1880s, whose exact composition is still used to this day. The Talmud has evolved into a page-by-page snapshot of nearly 2,000 years of collaborative discussion. Commentaries that are separated by centuries talk to each other across the page. Today, almost all editions and even digital Talmud apps still rely on the Vilna edition's composition and Bomberg's 16th century layout and pagination. Even the few that don't use his layout still use Bomberg's page numbers for reference, allowing readers to know where they are in the version that has become the standard. Daf Yomi, the practice of studying one page of Talmud a day, was proposed by Rabbi Meir Shapiro in 1923 as a way to link Jews together all over the world. Taking advantage of the fact that all Talmud editions are essentially identical, Daf Yomi enables study groups worldwide to literally be on the same page. Although studying Talmud is often associated with Orthodox men, nowadays, learning Talmud brings people together across continents and backgrounds. It's studied by Jews across the denominational spectrum, including Orthodox, Conservative, Reform, Reconstructionist, and the avowedly secular. They're learning on planes, trains, and automobiles. In a way, the Talmud's layout captures some of Judaism's most important values: scholarship, debate, history, memory, and community. At the heart of it all is the value Judaism places on both unity and diversity, and searching for truth through study and collaboration. Thanks for watching! If you like what we're doing, consider subscribing. And if you have a topic you want us to tackle, let us know in the comments below.